Has anyone else noticed how desperately the media is trying to bury or otherwise discredit the information coming out from these so-called Obamagate transcripts? You might even be watching and wondering what the hell I'm talking about because you watch MSNBC and CNN and think this is all just a right-wing conspiracy. Funny how the only real scandals are those involving Republicans, never Democrats. I'm glued to this stuff, and even I have a hard time following all the legal jargon and how it all fits together. After all, who am I? Just some guy in an awesome Quake shirt in his basement making videos. I'm also a guy with a channel that's constantly targeted by the censors at YouTube. And it's thanks to sponsors like My Patriot Supply that I'm able to continue putting out content for this channel. Sorry for the interruption, I know how much you all love ads, but just give me 1 minute to tell you about this special offer for my viewers from this episode's sponsor, My Patriot Supply. Friends, we are living in a strange new world. Things are not normal now. And they probably won't return to normal anytime soon. Food shortages will be the next shoe to drop. Will you be prepared? Or will you panic like everyone else when the grocery stores near you are out of food? Don't let the coming reality turn you into a victim. Make survival your top priority by building an emergency food supply today. I personally trust and use My Patriot Supply. You can too. They're the go-to experts in emergency preparedness. And best of all, they have a guarantee policy that will knock your socks off. Right now, you can save $100 off a full 4-week supply of their delicious and nutritious food that lasts 25 years in storage. You do not want to be unprepared when the next emergency or disaster strikes. Go to preparewithdronetek.com right now. That's preparewithdronetek.com. Act now while supplies last. Like I was saying before the ad, we need someone with some real credibility to explain Obamagate, not just for us, but for people out there that might not understand it and think it's just a right-wing conspiracy theory. So I decided to bring on a guy with real credibility who knows this scandal back and forth in his sleep. Robert Noir. He's a 35-year-old lifelong resident of Pennsylvania. He graduated from Clarion University of Pennsylvania, where he became part of the very first team of that university ever to get into the national debate tournament. Since then, he ran for District 12 in the special election of 2019 and recently became the host of Pennsylvania Patriots Radio on WEJS 104.1 FM, Williamsport, PA. Robert, welcome. Go ahead and just tell all of us what Obamagate is really all about.
I think that people, right, they're using it as a catch-all, right? So I always kind of hated the gate thing, but in this case, it makes sense. And the reason is the comparisons to Watergate. So the way I would define it is Obamagate to me is his weaponization of core institutions in order to go after political opponents. Now, the evidence that we're seeing is his attacks on Donald Trump. I think that we'll find out that he weaponized. We already know, for example, he weaponized the IRS to go against Republicans. Mm-hmm. Now, did he specifically order it or not? That's something we could get into. But that to me is what Obamagate is. It is, we have all these core institutions such as the IRS, the EPA, intelligence agencies, and instead of acting independently, they have acted as if they're just, as Eric Holder said, wingmen of Barack Obama, and they've attacked anyone who could be a potential thorn in the side to him politically or to his political legacy. And so now, are we including, what do you include in Obamagate? Are we just talking about Michael Flynn now? Are we talking about the whole Russia collusion hoax? I would say that I include all of that, all of the conspiratorial Obama setting up to spy on his opponents and then leaking to the press, using his allies in the mainstream media, all of which to win both propaganda victories in the press, but also use the authority of the law enforcement and intelligence agencies in order to spy on his opponents. But, I mean, the irony is, though, if we look at Watergate, what was the big deal about Watergate? Of course, you had Nixon destroying 15 minutes of tapes and lying about it. But the underlying scandal was a couple of buffoons from Nixon's team sought to spy on his opponent by rifling through a hotel room in the middle of the night. Two people.
Right.
Now, instead of that, if Nixon had weaponized the FBI, CIA, and NSA to spy on every single thing his opponent was doing. So I guess this is Watergate on steroids. Obamagate is. Yeah. But I mean, so the gate thing makes sense in terms of this. But again, it's hilarious because the exact same people that still pat themselves on the back and say, oh, Watergate was such a big deal and the press finally did something to save America. They took down a sitting president. Those same people, the people in the press, the Democratic parties, etc., they've done everything they can to propagandize Obamagate and allow to bury it, to justify it, and things like that. So they're literally on the exact opposite side. And they keep saying, they keep saying, like, oh, what Trump did, this is compared to Nixon. No, what Obama did is 10 times worse than what Nixon did.
Right.
But nothing Trump was accused of was anything like this.
Yeah. And I remember saying the same thing when the IRS thing was going on, because it was like he was using this institution to target his political opposition. And I don't want to get into a whole bunch of that, but it was pretty clear to me that there was shenanigans going on there when the director, when they wanted her hard drives, the director's all, oh, no, we destroyed those. We don't have any of that data. You know, I guess it turned out later they did, but.
Right. And the only reason that's worth mentioning that here is, one, to show how systemic this was under Obama. But second, because the defense that's given of Obama is, and I find this incredibly laughable, but this is how Obama defends himself and other people defend him. The old, I didn't know about that until I read it in the newspaper line. Mm. Like, so apparently, according to these people, Obama was the most clueless human being in the world. He didn't even know what average people like me and you knew. He was just sitting, oh, I'm sorry, yeah. I didn't know my IRS was targeting conservatives. Oh, even when I was in the Oval Office meeting with all these people that were unmasking Flynn, I had no clue. And what you see is, it's not a condition where I think that Obama's sitting in a shady room smoking a cigar like, okay, Lois Lerner, here's what I want you to do at the IRS. It was that he let it be known that they had a mandate, because they're morally superior to us and they know more than us, that they had a mandate to do whatever they wanted to make sure that their agenda got through. And that trickled down to every agency he had, where they said, it's okay to be corrupt. It's okay to break the rules, because we are the saviors of the world. We're doing what's right. So a lot of people, what you'll see now is a lot of CNN, MSNBC, the next step is just going to go with the few bad apples theory, which is, oh, Obama didn't know. Oh, the higher ups didn't know that Peter Strzok's a bad apple. Maybe Brennan was a bad apple, but everyone else was great. And that's garbage. The buck stops here. It stops with Obama. He's the one who was in charge when all of this was going on.
Yeah, and I just want to point out, that's something going back to the Obama administration, people like me were pointing out all the time, is that Obama always seemed to somehow be separate from what was going on in the government. So we went from like the media, anything that went on, it was the Bush administration.
Yep.
Bush administration does it. When Obama was president, not only did they just like not report on things that were bad, but they would just generally say the government or something to that effect, always to make it look like or seem like Obama was not involved with that. What exactly are these transcripts that were released by the DOJ? And, you know, what do you, I don't know if you've looked over all of them or if you've seen everything that's juicy in them, but what do you like, what's your big takeaway from those?
So what these transcripts were, was Adam Schiff's been sitting on these, and what they are, their testimony during the beginning of sort of the House's investigation into Russiagate. And so they interviewed people from, you know, people like Brennan and Clapper. They also interviewed people in the Obama administration. They interviewed the head of CrowdStrike, which was the agency that looked and determined that Russia hacked the DNC and the FBI relied on. And what these were transcripts that was just testimony of their interviews. There's nothing in it that on its own would seem that salacious. The reason that it's salacious is, particularly because it was being withheld by Adam Schiff, is that while all of these people, such as Clapper and Brennan, were testifying, we have no evidence that anyone in Trump's camp colluded with Russians in an illegal way. We have no evidence that the Steele dossier is true. While Schiff is, or while these people are being interviewed saying that, and Schiff's privy to that, Schiff's then those same days going on national television saying, I've seen direct proof that people in Trump's campaign conspired with Russia to steal the election. That was a blatant lie. And the reason that Schiff has held on to these documents for so long was to withhold that fact from coming out to the American people. And it's to the everlasting shame of the media that they allowed Schiff to get away with this. Even if you're a propagandist in the media, like say a Jake Tapper or an Anderson Cooper, and you're cheering for Trump to go down and you're cheering for Obama to be the man, when you get a little PO'd to know that your audience, you brought someone on repeatedly that lied directly to your audience and to you. Wouldn't that upset you? If you were Jake Tapper, wouldn't you come out today and be like, look, Adam Schiff will never be on my show again. The guy's like, but instead, they love Adam Schiff.
They double
further
down,
proving they're not journalists at all. They're propagandists.
Right. Well, and they're invested in this. They're deep in this, you know, knee deep in the shit, as they would say.
Yeah.
Like you said, they basically, whether knowingly or unknowingly, were used as props for propaganda to create this narrative. And it's the only way this works is with the media. Right. And there's other examples of this kind of thing, like when Comey, you know, had that meeting with Trump, and then he told him, oh, you know, I got to tell you about this document, you know, and then him doing that, him going to Trump and saying, oh, there's this document, the P dossier or whatever you want to call it, Steele dossier. There's this document. Then he immediately calls, was it Clapper? And then Clapper goes on CNN, or was it Brennan?
I think it was Brennan. Yeah. Okay. What had happened was Brennan worked for CNN. And Brennan calls up James Comey and says, oh, you know, did you hear about this P dossier? You should really tell Trump about it. And so Comey allegedly, his original version we heard was Comey goes to Trump because Comey was worried that these salacious allegations would make it out in the press. So he talks to Trump and he says, oh, you know, I just want to inform you. He doesn't say we think that you're a spy for Russia or that we think people connected to you are with Russia. He just mentions the P part. He's like, oh, this P document's out there. And I wanted you to know because CNN's sitting on it and we're worried they're going to run this story. Then word of that gets back to Brennan and CNN, who then use Comey's meeting as the excuse to run this story. Exactly. Now, the reason this fits into what we were just saying, if you're James Comey at that point and we're taking you at face value and you're like, man, I really need to inform the president because I'm worried the press will run this if they find a reason. And then you find out someone in your team leaked that and they used your very words, James Comey's very words, as the reason to run the story. Wouldn't you be furious if you're James Comey? But no, he's not furious. Instead, he's perfectly fine with it. And then we later find out that one of the reasons for that was he met with all the top brass at the FBI before the meeting with Trump that he claimed to all of us in America was just to brief Trump about this P dossier. And they all decided, take notes in case Trump incriminates himself in some sort of crime. What was the alleged crime that Trump committed? I mean, this is the sort of nonsense that, and that goes right in with the Obamagate theme, which is they were treating everyone like criminals with no evidence of it. And what the Democrats and the media will say is, ah, this is proof that the investigation was warranted because look, we've got these people guilty of crimes. But if you go back and you look at each individual case, like we could look at every single case and I could show you the corruption behind every single person. I could show you the corruption behind. But what's the main theme? The theme was Russia interfered in our election. And did Trump's team help them do that? That's what everything comes down to. And so when we go to the definitive answer, the 3 years of investigation answer, it was the Mueller report, right? That's where they're going to explain. Mueller was tasked with, and we could get into exactly what he was tasked with, but what we were told Mueller was tasked was investigating Russian interference, investigating whether or not Trump's team colluded with Russia, and investigating whether there was obstruction of justice. But that investigating Russian interference, that was his prima facie task. He said, yes, they did interfere in two incidents. One was Russian trolls used Pokemon Go and Facebook to post ads. That's 50% of the interference, people, right there. The second was Russia hacked the DNC. Now, if we could prove that Russia didn't interfere, or if there are allegations that Russia didn't even favor Trump, the whole house of cards fall. And what we've been able to prove based on these documents that have just been released is that's exactly the case. There is no proof that Russia hacked the DNC. The DOJ had to leave those 12 Russian trolls off the hook because they had no proof they were working on behalf of the Kremlin government. And now we're finding out that John Brennan, director of the CIA, buried intelligence that showed that actually Russia wanted Hillary to win.
The transcripts are showing all these people basically said one thing during their testimony, and then they went out in the media and said another. That was who all was that? It was Rice.
With Susan Rice, we had Clapper was quoted as saying they had no proof. Brennan said that there was no proof. And that what they're saying is when they're asked under oath and it's the cameras aren't on, they're admitting like, well, we don't have proof that anyone connected to Trump committed any crime. We don't have proof that the Steele dossier was true. And this is a theme over and over. We actually saw from years ago, we saw in Comey's public testimony in front of Congress that he admitted when they talked about the allegations in the Steele dossier, he called it salacious and unverified. But at the time he was saying that, his FBI was using it to get FISA warrants to wiretap people connected to Trump's team. So it's right. The public story. And you're exactly, that's one of the reasons I love your channel, is the focus on the media. People love to downplay now. They say everybody knows the media is corrupt. That's not true. The media still sets a very, like a threshold, or it sets a bar for what a lot of people get to hear. It's not just the traditional media. Maybe it's Stephen Colbert on his show. Maybe it's Hollywood and what they say, but they control this narrative. And by controlling that narrative, they allow things that would outrage the average American to be buried, or they make excuses for it. Let's look at the Flynn situation here briefly. So with Flynn, it's very difficult to understand what's going on. The first thing that came out here in this past month was we had proof from higher ups at the FBI admitting, asking the question in their own notes, what are we trying to get from the interview of Flynn? To get him to lie so we could get him or do we want the truth so we could get him locked up or fired? Now think about what this means. Just forget about the fact that it's the FBI. Think about local law enforcement. Just think about this for a second. Say law enforcement thinks some sort of crime was committed. They think the local pizzeria is running drugs out of it or something. And so they wiretap that pizzeria, and they have transcripts of all that pizzeria's phone calls. And none of it shows evidence of any crime whatsoever. Can you imagine then your local police going, well, there's no crime here. I know. Let's get that pizzeria owner in here. Ask him a bunch of difficult questions in the hopes that we could get him to lie in some way. That way we could cause him to lose his business and go to jail. That's nonsense. That's exactly what they did to Flynn. Right. And we know this. We know that that's what happened. And that's just the tip of the iceberg.
Yeah. So I know exactly what you're Perry been doing all this time. Like if they're not gonna, if the Logan Act has not been prosecuted since its inception, and we know that John Kerry is doing that very thing all the time, what, that's just another example of how this entire thing is a fraud.
Right. And that's what me and you have said the entire time. We're not just sycophants that are like, our side can do whatever they want. We've said the entire time, if crimes could be proven connected to Trump or people connected to him, that's fine. Hold them accountable. All we ask is that that's applied equally to all sides. Well, and that's right. That's what Obamagate is. Even the judge in the Manafort trial admitted, you're not after Manafort. You're trying to tighten the screws on him as tight as possible, hoping that he'll flip on Trump. Because why were they after Trump in the first place? Here's what Trump's big crime was. You ready for this? Trump won the election. That's the crime, right? Trump wasn't the establishment's choice. And so he had to be made a lesson of, right? And so they raided his lawyers in the middle of the night. They wiretapped his team. They did all this crap, right? I mean, in the case of Roger Stone, the FBI actually contacted CNN. So CNN was outside of Roger Stone's house with cameras while they pulled a 70-year-old man out in his underwear with 17 agents holding AR-15s. I mean, that's insanity. And then if you look at the juxtaposition, now remember, we're focusing on Obamagate in terms of the Russia investigation, the spying on Trump, and that's all good. But remember, these same cast of characters to the T, Peter Strzok, James Comey, Rebecca, Rosenstein, McCabe, the exact same cast of characters were in charge of the Hillary Clinton investigation. And so with the Hillary investigation is the first investigation I could see in the history of law enforcement in the world that was ran like this. I watch Law and Order and I see, this is what they do. Oh, you're after the drug kingpin? Well, you get the guy in the street and you prove, hey, we caught you with bags of weed. You're going to go to jail for 15 years because of your priors, unless you have something to say about someone higher up than you. And thus, that's how they get to the higher up people. But this is what the FBI thought about. That's exactly what they did with Trump. But when it came to Hillary, they're like, here's what we'll do. We'll give everyone immunity, even though we know they committed crimes. We'll let them off the hook. We'll smash their devices that prove they committed crimes. Hell, we'll even let them delete subpoenaed evidence. And then once we give them all immunity, we'll say, hey, do you guys have anything to say negative about Hillary Clinton? And they were like, no. Okay, case closed. That's what they did in the Hillary. The exact same people that you see to this day that are fighting tooth and nail for Flynn to still go to jail. Those people that entrapped Flynn were the exact same people in charge of the Hillary investigation that were like, we'll smash evidence. We'll give people immunity that we know committed crimes and not charge anyone. It's unbelievable.
Yeah. Why should people pay attention to this? And why is Obamagate real and not just a right-wing conspiracy theory?
Obamagate don't get me wrong, the buck stops with Obama in this case. But what it is it's systemic of what's been going on for our government for more than 30 years. And what that is your vote doesn't matter. What you, the normal Americans, want don't matter. It's unelected bureaucrats. It's wealthy oligarchs and lobbyists, people like Bill Gates and George Soros. It's politicians that are only concerned about consolidating power. And it's on both sides of the aisle. You don't think that Mitt Romney and John McCain weren't just as involved as Hillary Clinton in this? Of course they were. This Obamagate is the clearest example we have of the amount of corruption. What they accuse you of is what they're doing. They say Trump was abusing power. They were literally using the most powerful investigative agency in the history of the world to spy on their political opponents. We talk about how Watergate's a big deal. That was two buffoons trying to spy in a hotel room on their opponent. Here we have the most powerful investigative agency that could tear apart your life, that could bankrupt you without you even charging you with a crime, that could look at any email or phone call that you've ever made. And they're being used as a tool by the establishment and the Obama administration. I say all the time, whatever your issue is, if you're on the left or right, if you're on the left, maybe it's climate change. If you're on the right, maybe it's Second Amendment. None of that matters as long as there are unelected bureaucrats that are actually controlling our government. Chuck Schumer said on Rachel Maddow's show right after Trump was nominated, before he was sworn in, that Trump should be afraid to criticize the intel agencies because they'd find six ways from Sunday at getting back at him. He was telling America, all of us, regardless if you're right or left, that the most powerful elected leader of the free world has to be fearful of unelected bureaucrats because they run the show. And that should shock and frighten each and every one of us. And lastly, you see how this plays out. And maybe you say, look, I don't care. I'm struggling right now. I lost my job, or, you know, I'm fearful of this virus or whatever. And so you think that this doesn't matter, that this story doesn't matter. But I assure you, the same establishment voices that lied to you for 3 years about Russia are the same ones controlling policy right now that are lying to you and fear-mongering to consolidate power, to wipe out the middle class, and to have this massive wealth redistribution and introduction of all these policies. Is it any wonder that the exact same things we were talking about how the media going after fake news and wanting to censor voices like ours on YouTube, that they use the Russia situation for that? And now they're using the COVID situation for that. Oh, you can't say certain things about COVID. And you're absolutely right, Ryan. This is war. And you can see, because these corrupt people still run the show, they will use each and every issue they can to silence us, to consolidate power, and to screw over the average person.
Rob, I think that we've summed it up probably, or you have summed it up just about as eloquently as can be done in this amount of time. It really is going to fall on individuals, I think, to go out and just do a little bit of reading. Just read a little bit. Find some, a middle-of-the-road source, or just go, I'll link the raw transcripts in this video. Go and just scour over them. Look at the parts with Strzok and Page. Look at the parts about the fact there's no evidence against Flynn, and they wanted the investigation was supposed to have been shut down. I mean, Strzok and Page, I don't want to get back into this, but they both were like, oh, our stupidity is working for us now because we didn't shut down the investigation.
That's right.
So go and check it out for yourself. Go and check out Rob's channel. The guy is a machine. He is a fountain of information. He can teach you a lot. So I highly recommend you go check out his channel. I'll link that as well. So Rob, thanks a lot for being here and educating everybody.
Appreciate thanks. It's always a blast. Anytime.
That's all for this episode. Please hit that like button, share, and subscribe. If you'd like to support this channel, you can do so on one of these platforms, and you can find all the links in the description or pinned comment. Thanks for watching. Keep coming back. What?